Hello and welcome to The Vote with me, Frank LeDuc, and my guest today, Cllr Robert Nemeth, who represents Wish on Brighton Hove City Council. Good morning, and sit on the Economic and Development and Economic Development and Culture Committee. The committee names of the council are just so long. I sometimes lose the will to live.
Before and they
I
get change
to the end of the sentence. Yeah, no, absolutely. You also sit, apart from on committees, you also sit on something called the King Alfred Project Board. I don't know if that is still going to exist after last week when the council chose its development partner for this huge project. But first of all, what does it involve, sitting on a project board like this? What are you doing?
King Alfred Project Board is about not doing the work to help design it, but to smooth the path for the two bidders who were, until last week, pitching for the big contract.
And so does that, I mean, you've got presumably expert advisors, council officials, and indeed people from a firm of consultants outside Deloitte's.
That's right. Every portfolio area in the council is represented, whether it be housing, planning, finance, law, the planning department.
Because this is such a big decision and there's presumably an eagerness to get it absolutely right. I mean, not least to make sure there's no legal challenge, if you like, from the losing bidder, among other things.
That's right, and that's why we have this standstill period of 10 days, not just out of courtesy to the loser, to make sure that everything was done properly, but also to avoid any sort of legal challenge that could derail the project.
And I mean, in terms of the winning developer that pitched is the house builder Cress Nicholson and the Star Trust, a local charity set up by Rob Star, who's from Hove. Set up the Star Trust in memory of his father, which is a charity. And he's got great ideas. He's been sort of beavering away behind the scenes for quite a while, I think, with his vision for what he'd like King Alfred to be. I'm sure these things involve some compromise. But have you heard much from the likes of Rob Star himself and the people pitching?
Yeah, I have. You were around even at the public meeting that we held probably four years ago, organised by Mike Weatherly, the MP for Hove at the time. Rob Star was around even back then with a dream to one day get involved in developing the site.
And I think people thought he was sort of the outsider, if you like, because
he was at the time, but
amazing story. I mean, this is also at the same time as he was trying to sort out a charity swim across the channel.
Oh, it's amazing.
He runs a business.
Where does all that energy come from?
I don't know. I'm very jealous, actually. Whatever he's having, I want some of it. So it's quite a nice story in a way, with a local businessman who's sort of grown up here, loves the place, wanting to, you know, everyone's got their ideas about what they'd like the King Alfred to emerge having, looking like, etc. I guess.
I bet he's dying to say more.
Sure.
I mean, we're bound by our word to not say anything for a few more days, but of all people with all that energy, I bet he's dying.
I'm sure. I can't wait to see him and hear some of this.
Well, you haven't even seen the designs yet, of course.
No, of course, absolutely. And again, we're looking forward very much to the first day when they're unveiled. I mean, one of the other things I found interesting was actually the runners up, there were a shortlist of two. I mean, there were more than that originally, but the runners up also had a French firm, Boyg, but they had some local links with an architect, Nick Lomax, who has.
I wouldn't obsess too much over the fact that they're French. I mean, it's very much an English portion of the company. I'd say French owned, but
operating very much
English run, I'd say.
And but you had local people like Nick Lomax, the architect, working with them. Ed Allison Wright, a local developer, sort of a partner on the ground to them. Again, presumably helping them navigate the.
That's right.
The council and various options locally.
Yeah, and part of this standstill really is out of courtesy. The loser in all of these long procurement competitions has spent hundreds of thousands of pounds. And it's wrong to just suddenly announce it without proper reference to them. Just make a final check that everything,
giving feedback, that kind of thing.
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, because it's not, presumably it's not it's not beyond the bounds of possibility that the council and we might be working together on some other project at some other time.
Exactly.
So it's a maintaining good relations. There was some disappointment, I think, from the likes of Shiver's Swimming Club that doesn't appear to be the prospect of a 50-metre pool, which is competition standard, and Shiver's a pretty good standard club, and at the moment they're shipping out dozens and dozens of our young swimmers to Crawley every week to swim at the K2 to train in a competition pool.
I've been working with Shiver's for probably same amount of time, three or four years. I mean, before I was elected, my involvement, my motivation for getting elected was to get this 50-metre pool. But the problem was, the deal was wrapped up by the time I finally got onto the project board.
I mean, is it conceivable that we could have a 50-metre pool at some point, or is that really a done dusted now? No way.
Well, the answer is, we could have a 50-metre pool, but it won't be at the King Alfred. It will be at Peter Pan Playground with an entirely different project, and it will be outdoor. So, I mean, I've seen plans last week for the Peter Pan Playground pool.
So that's, I mean...
Bit of a tongue twister.
No, indeed. Those plans were aired, I think, was it last year or the year before, and they're presumably now beginning to take shape as well. There's some more to look forward to, actually. That looked...
More plans that the public haven't seen yet, which are quite incredible.
There was an image that I think that was based on a pool that the same people had put out, had used in Australia somewhere. I know we're not quite...
It does look very different to that.
They've got sand on the Bondi Beach. We've got very large grains of sand on our beach. Some people call them pebbles. But is there still any prospect for bowls fans, for example? They were hoping for four Crown Green rings so that they could hold, again, competition standard matches. Are we shortchanging people on things like the swimming and the bowls, or is it possible that...
In some ways, I wish I'd been elected when the specification was written, but the minimum specification for bowling was three rinks, and the current King Alfred Bowls Club operates on six rinks. You could probably get away with five rinks, but the minimum spec was three, and again, details will be released, but at the current level, it won't work for King Alfred Bowls Club, which is very sad. But a bigger problem, in fact, for them is not having a sports centre for 2 years. In many ways, that's the bigger problem than
likewise,
afterwards.
Presumably for Shiverers too. I mean, they've already got sort of good arrangements with other pools to use their facilities, but very few that are, the standard they'd probably like and want.
Yeah, there's many operators of the King Alfred who will struggle actually for a while. I mean, there's Cheetah's Gym.
Yes.
Local institution, the boxing club.
Yep.
The dancing club.
Yes.
There's many groups that use the King Alfred that are going to have to make. Arrangements.
It's funny, I know you can't, we haven't got smell-o-vision, but when you say Cheetah's Gym, it evokes a certain, I don't know.
Aroma.
Yes, yes, of testosterone and
best
sweat.
Best not bottled.
Yeah, best not bottled, yes. Is this all cut and dried? I mean, is there no chance that the Cress Nicholson and the Star Trust can be lobbied as they work up their designs now designs?
I had a late night conversation with the bowlers last night, and I said to them, don't give up. Where there's a will, there's a way. So don't give up. Sit down. The planning stage itself is a long process.
Yes, I mean it's not likely, but it's not cut and dried yet.
I'd agree. Yeah. I mean, the problem with planning is that things work against the public. You know, it gets taller. They start removing facilities. That's what you don't want. People aren't going to object if things are added.
Perhaps an interesting lesson for any developer there, particularly one of the King Alfred at the moment, that how to win the public over, because it certainly attracted a lot of opposition last time, and a 26-storey sort of tower's got permission. So something more modest.
Fortunately, a lot lower actually, 26 down to 18.
This summer we're looking at 18, 565 flats, so fewer homes on the site as well.
Fewer homes, 751 down to 560. So a big drop. I mean, essentially they're. The number of homes, 560, is how many you need to pay for a £40 million sports centre.
You're on the project board. Do you know, are some of these going to be affordable homes? Has that been factored in?
Yeah, it has, 20%. And that's why the figures are fairly tight. I can't say too much, of course. I'm only commenting on what's in the public domain.
Yeah.
But two bidders submit plans, and as you have two, you can work out approximately. And of course, with Deloitte's expertise, you can work out what is required.
Yes.
To pay for 20% affordable homes and a £40 million sports centre.
The whole project seems to be, we're told, is worth about £400 million with the homes, the leisure centre and everything. I'm presuming that's the selling price of the homes.
I don't think the council has released that, so you have a good source, I think.
Okay. When are we likely to see work start?
Middle of 2017. So that's a year of planning.
So subject to planning permission going through on time, which... I'm guessing there's a greater will to get the ball rolling with this at the moment. We've got a a great deal of need for housing, as well as obviously wanting to upgrade the leisure facilities. I mean,
yeah, it's a wasted site that's been sitting there for probably, I bet people have talked about developing it for at least 30 years. I imagine in the 80s when they added
more
the
than
pools
40
on
years.
The back. Yeah?
More than 40 years. So I think Hove Borough Council put it out there in about the late 60s, the very end of the 60s and start of the 70s, people were beginning to work up plans. Astonishing, isn't it? But I mean, I was, you know, I said to earlier in the week to one of your colleagues, you know, your political rivals, if you like, Jill Mitchell, we had the same with the Jubilee Library site, you know, that went from the 50s to the early noughties. So, but
I don't know how these sites can sit there for so long without being developed. It's crazy in a way.
Well, we'll come on to some more major projects maybe after the break and one or two other things, but don't go for now, and please join us after these ads. Hello and welcome back to The Vote with me, Frank LeDuc, and my guest today, Councillor Robert Nemeth, who represents Wish on Wish Ward on Brighton and Hove City Council and sits on various committees, economic development,
environment, transport, sustainability.
So all the committees with the long names and the big portfolios. So
All the fun ones.
Yeah, I was going to say you did well for someone who's just been elected. That's quite a hefty slice of responsibility there. One of the things that's come up probably on one of the committees that you're not a member of, actually, I think, is the news that a housing subcontractor overcharged the council by more than £300,000, it's believed. That's prompted quite a bit of concern, not just among those on the relevant committees, housing, audit, but among, I think, the council and the wider public. First of all, do you know, are we going to see this money back?
Definitely going to see it back, but I don't understand why we haven't got it back already. It's all very well Mears saying we're going to pay it back, but I'd like it yesterday.
I mean, the interest. I mean, I feel I should sort of, for the sake of fairness, say that it was a subcontractor, not Mears themselves, who overcharged the council. And Mears have also, I think, whereas the council will be refunded, we're told, Mears are probably going to be the one. If anyone takes a hit, it will be them, as it were. Although they're trying to recover the money themselves.
I hope they do.
There's been some criticism that we don't know who the subcontractor is, and of course they're barred from council work now. So presumably, ordinary members of the public are being left exposed to the risk of being ripped off by the same person or the same organisation.
My colleague, Councillor Mary Mears, is very much on the case here, so I'm sure we'll get to the bottom of it.
And I should, again, I feel I should say at this point as well, because I've had this conversation with Mary a number of times, Mears, the housing contractor, is absolutely no relation to Mary Mears, the councillor. It's just one of those coincidences of name.
Hyde Housing has nothing to do with Linda Hyde.
No, indeed. I mean, I don't know if it's your party just all got developers' names or builders' names, but I'm waiting for Nemeth Corporation to rise, you know, from the from somewhere. So, I mean, some people have been worried about the message this all sends out. I don't know if you've got a view on that.
I've got a very strong view on it, because the council can't be seen to be a soft touch, and in a way it has been since the release of the data on how much it was ripped off by the coin collection company that collects the coins from our meters around the city. £3 million. How was it not noticed that £3 million, £3.5 million, had gone astray? Big property companies, the biggest in the country, such as Land Securities, employ the same contractor, and they didn't get into this pickle.
The coin collectors thing was a really interesting fraud, actually, if I can call it that in that way, because I mean, at one point we were owed more than £4 million, and I know they managed to recover some of this money, but CoinCo went into administration. Some of the directors were arrested.
We won't get that back.
To me, it seems highly unlikely. I know the council have said, well, we won't say never, but it does seem highly unlikely. I mean, there were other local losers, like the Royal Sussex County Hospital, the parking there. They didn't lose anywhere near as much. Yeah. I think about.
There were many national losers, but there are also many national bodies who got their money back because they were on the ball. And I'd rather have seen Brighton and Hove City Council as one of those who noticed straight away.
This is not the first time a contract like this has gone awry. I mean, I know there's a new contractor doing it now, but CoinCo's predecessors also became insolvent, owing large sums of money to councils. In this case, I think Brighton and Hove did get its money back quite quickly, but other councils in Sussex lost out to a similar situation.
Yep. And in a way, this is the knee-jerk reaction to this was, of course, getting rid of many of the meters and bringing in or embracing further a quite unpopular parking charge system. Pay by phone.
I think, I mean, presumably that will become more popular if there's a discount rather than a surcharge for using it.
Yeah, the logic was there to begin with when we still had meters. People were happy to pay a bit more because they were choosing to pay by phone. But as soon as you get rid of the meters, it becomes a stealth tax.
And with this as well, I think, is it some of your colleagues have advocated bringing back some of the vouchers as an alternative for example, tourists and those who don't have or struggle with smartphones. People who've got arthritis, for example, rheumatism.
That's right. Yeah, my councillor, Tony Janio.
Do you think we'll see progress on that?
There's no argument against vouchers. The voucher system isn't expensive. People would just be stubborn if they didn't embrace that.
And so it's a possibility that could run alongside what we do already.
Yeah.
With things like this, you know, the coin co thing, I know this is not the only issue of sort of the cost to the council that you've sort of taken up recently. I don't know if what other ones have been on the in the landscape, as it were.
Well, two different examples spring to mind. Local to my ward is the Ingram estate on Portland Road, where there's a break-in in Sanders House, a sheltered living scheme. Back in December, television stolen, Nintendo stolen.
I mean, we laugh, but actually these are quite, for the people who live there, this is part of what, you know.
It was awful. I mean, I visited the residents and they expect footage to be released the next day, as do I as councillor. So I'm in touch with the council, the police, pretty much every day saying, why is this footage not released? They have pictures of the criminal, some sort of silly miscommunication between council and police. And it's end of January and there's no footage out there. And I wonder whose data are they protecting? Is it the is it the criminals? Why are we not? Why is there this? Where does a drive to not release footage come from?
Why would you not just release it?
If the police aren't releasing it, the council should.
And vice versa, presumably.
Yeah, the priority is not to be seen as a soft touch. It might not be a high-profile theft, but it's important to my residents, especially the residents within Sanders House on the Ingram estate.
But to see that something's being done as well, to try to... I mean, detectives have what they call the golden hour after a crime, when you can... But if you've got CCTV footage of the suspected perpetrator, there seems to be... Data Protection Act, for example, which is often cited as a defence for not releasing information, actually specifically says you can release personal data for the purposes of solving and detecting
crime.
Yeah,
quite right. I'm not interested in the slightest in bureaucratic measures that prevent this kind of thing. I just put it out there, and if we find the guy, we can put him in jail, stop him from ripping off other people.
And have you had an explanation yet as to why this isn't...
Some sort of miscommunication, and then... the police don't appear to have done anything since.
Maybe
it's not a high-profile enough crime to, because it's a former council estate. I just don't know.
Interesting. Well, we'll
I'm staying on the case though. You'll hear back from me.
I look forward to that. And again, you know, I mean, as you know, in sort of working as a journalist away from this program as well, we'll pick up on that as well.
I can give you a second example.
Yeah.
Fly tipping within our parks costs hundreds of thousands of pounds a year to pick up from travellers. And the council is just...
I mean, it's not just travellers who fly tip, is it?
The specific contract I have in mind relates specifically to traveller fly tipping in our parks. The council's going to put council tax money...
Unauthorised camps.
Unauthorised. Just in standard parks. 106 encampments last year, so two a week. And putting in about £300,000 a year now in clearing up the mess. And my residents aren't happy about that. There's enough things that they'd already like to see the... hard-earned cash being put into. It's wrong to put it into fly tipping. We should be catching people and fining them for fly tipping, not putting public money into clearing up the mess.
Is some of that money going into putting preventive measures, putting bins out, etc., when an unauthorised camp turns up?
No, it's just going into clearing up the mess.
Okay, and are we likely to see? Presumably, the argument is once the Travellers site at Horsdene opens, we'll have fewer. Unauthorised.
Yeah.
No, I mean, I don't think anybody realistically expects we won't have unauthorised camps in Brighton and Hove.
Yeah, there's only 12 pitches in Horsdene. And another scandal is the council has so far spent £2.5 million on 12 pitches. That's about £200,000.
That's 12 in addition to the ones that are there.
Yeah, that's
so
right.
We'll have nearly about a couple of dozen minutes.
Yeah, but to spend £200,000 on what essentially is a concrete drive and some showers. £200,000, you could build a big house for that.
Per hard standing, we're
talking
about.
£2.5 million in total now. which is another example of just costs running away, which means I probably not go down the paths of these expensive building projects in the first place.
I mean, talking of which, and we've got very little time left, but one of the things that we were talking about the King Alfred in the first half, and you've been sort of pushing on, you know, I know you're very keen to see major projects flow, not just along the seafront, but throughout the city. I mean, again, would I be right in saying that actually sort of while the Greens took a lot of flak, they did make some progress on this front?
Yeah, all credit to a councillor called Geoffrey Bowden, who I know you know very well from his past appearances on
he's been a regular
programme. Yeah. As the chair of the Economic Development Committee, well, last year. I mean, a number of projects have kicked off, not least the biggest that's ticking through at the moment, which is called the waterfront development, so a new Brighton Centre at Blackrock and a redevelopment of Churchill Square down to the sea, something that was kicked off and it takes several years to lead in. I'd be interested if there are schemes in the pipeline now that in 4 years' time maybe we'll be sitting talking about again.
I guess people don't realise just how long it takes to get the ball rolling, even on the preliminary stages of
Absolutely
some of these projects.
Yeah.
So, I mean, Geoffrey's been on the programme this week and wearing a different hat, wearing a health hat. But absolutely. So, what are you doing anything to sort of push for projects to be identified now that can be taken forward?
Well, one example that you touched on is treating the losing bidder of the King Alfred well. Because these are big developers and ultimately we do want to see people like that building in the city. So you have to keep people on board and we don't want them going away thinking Brighton isn't a place to do business.
And people have worried about that in the past, but let's hope that the King Alfred Progress and the Waterfront Scheme will change that. Robert, thank you very much for joining us on the vote.
Thanks,
do come again before too long.
And thank you.
Watch the vote again soon. Goodbye for now.